What's going on, guys? Today is Friday, October 9th, and that means it is time for my top 5 tech and gaming news stories of the day. Samsung is probably feeling pretty good after the successful launches, well, the eventually successful launches of both the Galaxy Fold, the Fold 2, and the Z Flip. These phones have been relatively successful, and I think have sold better than a lot of people expected them to. Well, it appears as though Samsung may not be done trying to innovate in the folding screen space. We are now seeing reports that Samsung, as well as LG, will join TCL, who unveiled a concept earlier this year, in producing a rolling screen concept. Now, if you're having a hard time visualizing what that might look like, TCL put out their video a while back. Basically, the thing would slide out like that and would make the screen bigger in that way. When you close it back in, the screen will roll back in around itself. It'll wrap around the chassis back into the body. Personally, I have always thought this design was the superior way to do this. You're not folding the thing back and forth, so you don't have the same crease. You're just rolling the screen, sliding it back in and underneath. I'm super excited to see what a company like Samsung or LG can do with this concept. Both of these companies are known for having kind of out there designs on the occasion, maybe LG more than Samsung, but nonetheless, the reports are Samsung and LG are both making a phone with that sort of design. Can't wait to hear more about that. On the OnePlus front, we finally have what we believe to be the appearance of the OnePlus 8T. First, we got a case from Amazon. This is how we get visuals on phones a lot of the time. Cases leak early. This is what the phone's going to look like. You get a pretty good view of the camera module there in the front. But then, shortly after that, OnePlus went ahead and said, oh, cat's out of the bag. Let's go ahead and just unveil this thing. So they released this cool, sketchy looking design doc sort of styled thing. And I think overall, the OnePlus 8T looks pretty cool. Let's see if we can freeze this here. You've got, of course, the 48 megapixel sensor here. I'm sure there's a wide angle telephoto. This may be a macro. Pretty good array of cameras. We're maintaining the physical slider here to toggle between silent, vibrate only, and normal ringing, which is a great OnePlus feature. I like this teal color as well. They don't show the front of the device, but we're pretty positive that we're going to get that same hole punch in the corner like we saw on the regular 8. And honestly, this thing is starting to look more and more like a Samsung phone. It looks very similar to the S20 series of phones with that big sort of squared camera bump in the top left corner of the back of the phone. Personally, I kind of preferred OnePlus putting their camera module in the center because it differentiated them from the plethora of phones that have them in that corner, which is where everyone seems to be putting their cameras now. But whatever, sure it'll be a pretty solid phone. So just the other day, I did my breakdown of the PlayStation 5 teardown video. And one of the things that I brought up and mentioned in this was that there is an NVMe M.2 slot for expandable storage in the PlayStation 5. So we finally have some details on what M.2 drives will work on your PlayStation 5. There's an interview with Mark Cerny just the other day where he said, quote, "We will be supporting certain M.2 SSDs. These are internal drives you can get in the open market and install in a bay on the PlayStation 5. Here's the catch, though. That commercial drive has to be at least as fast as ours. Games that rely on the speed of our SSD need to work flawlessly with any M.2 drive." He goes on to say, "No PCIe 3.0 drive can hit our required speeds of 5.5 gigabytes per second. However, the first 4.0 M.2 drives have now hit the market and we're seeing 4 to 5 gigabyte speeds. By the end of the year, I expect there will be drives hitting 7 gigabytes per second." So there you go. You're going to need a PCIe 4.0 drive that is going to be able to match that 5.5 gigabytes a second speed. This is not going to be cheap. I think a lot of people balked at the Xbox Series X expandable storage, their SSD being over $200. Well, guess what? An M.2 drive that's NVMe, you know, 4.0, PCIe 4.0, that is going to be very expensive. Expect prices well in excess of $250 if not even higher than that. Keep in mind, we're looking at 664 gigabytes of available system memory or storage, I should say, after the OS and all of these reserved storages are taken care of. That is not a lot of space on a system, considering that games like Call of Duty are taking up, you know, almost half of that by themselves. This is really important. We need more information from Sony on this, and as soon as we know for sure how this is going to work, you can expect a video on it. It looks like the sequel to the Galaxy Z Flip, the Z Flip 2, should be rocking the new Snapdragon 875, shocking pretty much no one. Of course, they're going to go with the newest, most high-end chip. The interesting thing here is that it looks like they're going to skip the 865. It looks like they went with the 855 Plus was the top end before. Well, now they're just going to go straight to the 875. And while we're getting reports of no under display camera, the hole punch might be shrinking a bit too. Personally, I always really liked the design of the Z Flip. I like the clamshell idea, I like closing the thing up. I think it's a really cool design. I think there's a lot of potential here. Some of the things that the Moto Razr did with the bigger screen on the front, I would love to see integrated into the Z Flip, because one of the biggest problems with a phone that has no external screen is you have to open it to see anything unless you're using a smartwatch. Can't wait to see what the Z Flip 2 is going to actually look like in the end. And last but not least, it looks like the PlayStation 5 is continuing to dominate pre-orders. We have an article here from gamesindustry.biz where they are citing 72% of the United States next-gen pre-order customers chose the PlayStation 5. There's some interesting numbers here saying that 15% of them managed to successfully pre-order a next-gen console. 72% went for the disc edition of the PS5, 30% went for the Series X, and 10% got the digital edition of the PS5. This is surprising because the PS5 digital edition is considerably cheaper. However, it appears that it was having some very limited numbers of these digital edition PS5s being available. That probably had a lot to do with why so few of them were pre-ordered. Only 8% chose the Xbox Series S. That's not too shocking though, because you figure people that are pre-ordering are the enthusiasts. They're going to go for the biggest, baddest console. Super interesting article here with a lot of really good numbers, but all in all, things are looking very, very positive for the PlayStation 5. As we've spoken in the past, the Xbox Series X doesn't need to sell 100 million consoles to be a success. They just need to get people to sign up for Game Pass, but things are really getting interesting. I'm personally surprised that the PS5 is dominating that much this early, but the momentum from the PS4 does appear to be carrying through to the PlayStation 5. So guys, that's all the news I have for you today. Be sure to check back every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday for my next top 5 tech and gaming news stories. And until then, stay nerdy, my friends. If you enjoy my content, please consider becoming a scary if literal member. You'll get access to a whole bunch of emoticons to use with live streams and a shout out on an upcoming video. Thanks as always for your continued support.